brake on the car is broken, you try to have another thing that kind of stops the gas in some sense. Okay? And so you can see the wild type RV are not responding, but the mutated RV are more sensitive to the drug. Which means in a patient, if you see those patients with those mutations, maybe they should respond better to that targeted therapy. Sam, you have a question?
I'm confused why it's low on that side means it's responding, and then on that side it's high meaning it's responding.
Ah, okay. So as I mentioned, RV is like a brake on a car. The car brake is broken, so the cancer cell is growing a lot. And this is kind of a stop on the gas pedal.
But why does the IC50 go up?
Yeah, so basically when the cells still have the brake, you can use the brake to stop the growth, and then the gas pedal doesn't help as much. It's when the brake is broken, and then the gas pedal is more important. Okay? And so that this is slightly different from the previous cases. And these are looking at mutation patterns, but you can also look at the gene expression. This is another drug, and you can see here, depending on the expression level of these different cell lines, they have different sensitivity. So this is one gene. Its expression, depending on whether it's high or low, will have different response to another inhibitor. And you can find a lot of these cases like that. Okay. Interestingly, we are even seeing this in the clinic. We actually, in January of this year, have a paper showing that the compound screens, we can identify cases where once you get the signature, usually it's not one gene. You know, it could be a collection of genes to give you a more robust readout. And when the patient, the tumor gene expression coming in, we correlate the genome-wide expression. So we have a genome-wide expression signature. And then if somebody's new tumor comes in, based on their tumor expression, we do the correlation. We can predict whether they are responding to the drug or not. And the signature is actually coming from the drug screen in the cell lines. Okay. I think we already had the restart on the video, so we will just continue. So, so in this particular case, is you test a thousand, cells for the same drug, and you want to ask for that drug which cells are sensitive, right? Which cells are resistant, and also what is mutated or differentially expressed in those sensitive cells. And so this is like you have a hammer, which is a drug, and you're trying to find the nail, which cancer will respond to this drug, right? And so instead of this drug focus, can we test the tumor-specific therapies? It's like, you know, when this patient comes in, you want to be able to test this patient and tell them whether they should go on some drugs. And initially, people, you know, like companies like Foundation Medicine, they are doing mutation profiling. Most of the hospitals right now are using mutation as the guidance, and so we can see whether that is a good way. So in addition to you know, just looking at mutations, there are ways to look at whether some genes are important. Again, you know, you can learn this from patients, but there are also models that we can learn from. And one way is this kind of genome-wise loss of functional screen. You could do gain of function screen or loss of function screen. Loss of function screen is probably the more popular ones. So the idea is if you can get the cell from that cancer, you know, some of the cancers, if you can actually derive a cell line from that patient tumor, you can then get rid of a gene one at a time to test whether getting rid of that gene, the cancer cell will die or not. Okay? You can get rid of the gene at the DNA level or RNA level. But one at a time. And you can see whether getting rid of that gene in that cell so you need some controls, probably, you know, some standard other cell lines. You can see, okay, this gene doesn't matter in other cells, doesn't matter in the other cells, and suddenly this patient tumor, this gene becomes very important. And if that gene has a drug, that patient will probably respond to that drug. Okay? And so, at the Broad Institute, there's a project called Achilles Heel. You know, Achilles is really strong, he's a really good fighter, right? Unbeatable. But then there's just one vulnerability. So the project idea is that cancer cell is growing so fast, it's really strong, but maybe it's just one vulnerability. You kill that gene, the cancer cell is dead. And so in the early days, what people do is, in this Achilles project, very early day, they look at SI or SH RNAs, which is, we didn't actually go in the lecture to explain this. So if you have an RNA of a gene, so this is a gene, and you have an RNA for this gene, which is, you know, one strand. But if you have another like short RNA, which is totally complementary to your original gene, when the cell sees this, it will degrade the RNA. The RNA will get degraded. The cell has an internal mechanism to do this. And so if this is the case, it would mean that in different cells, we can introduce a different short RNA to get rid of a different gene. And you can do this with something called a shRNA screen. Screen just means to test every gene, and you see whether the cells are dying. And early days, people test this by doing this in a 96 well plate. So you roll all the cells, and this one is knocking out gene 1, gene 2, gene 3, gene 4, and so on. Okay? So you can see that in this case. Let's see. By the way, so this needs to be introduced into the cell. And so initially you grow this in all the cells. You grow all the cells and you put this RNA into a little virus. The virus will express this little RNA and the virus will infect the cell and go into the cell. And then you will knock out the different gene in the different cells in here. But how do we make sure that they really get in? There needs to be some markers, like doxycycline, which will kill most of the cells unless they take up the virus that contains this little RNA. Okay, so you use a viral infection to introduce the RNA into the cell to make sure that it really contains the thing. And then once it goes in there, so the it will form this kind of a hairpin loop, and then they will go to the it's a much more complicated process. Anyway, at the end, there's a little RNA that targets the gene, and this RNA will be degraded, and you can test whether it changed the growth of the cell or not. But I would say that data was not so great, so let's just talk about that or what people do. So shRNA screen target the RNA, but recently what's the more exciting thing is people are now testing on the DNA side, using screening approaches as well. So how many of you have heard of the recent patent war between the Broad Institute and Berkeley on CRISPR? Yeah, so this is kind of a very interesting technology. So it was first discovered by, you know, the very basic science idea was actually discovered by Jennifer Doudna and Emmanuel Charpentier. They're like bacterial biologists. And so you know, we have immune system, but bacteria, they also have immune system. When they get infected by virus, they want to learn. They want to remember this is a bad guy, and next time have a way to deal with it. And so you probably know this is kind of like a standard virus. It will get infected, it will infect the bacteria cell in here, and then usually what it goes in is the DNA or the RNA that goes into the cell, and it will hijack the bacterial cell's own machinery for replicating DNA or RNA and making proteins. And so it will just replicate its DNA and make RNA, make proteins, package itself, and then break it up and infect more cells, right? If by any chance the bacteria is able to survive this attack and fend off this infection, the bacteria will find a short sequence about 1920 nucleotide long, and put this double-stranded RNA into its own genome. It's kind of like, I have seen this guy before, it's bad, and I have to remember this. And so it puts this into an array, and so there are some proteins here expressed, and right after this, these are the signatures of, you know, like, it's like the bad guy when the bacteria is one day older. who they owe. You know, whatever, so anytime there's a new bacteria infection, the new ones always get added in here. It's like, that's the most recent bad guys. So they get added in here, always get inserted. And then if this virus happened to come in here again, what happens is that these things are always expressed at a kind of low level. And so this is a protein, like a Cas-related protein. And then these little RNA will get expressed. So normally you will express a little bit of these RNA. And this thing can be expressed into little RNA. Then it will be attached to the proteins that are expressed in here and guide the protein to find a good match. And anytime there is a match, it will say, this bad guy came back again. Let's kill it. Okay? And so anytime old virus gets thinned off, its signature is being kept here. And the cell will always express a little bit of this signature, which is an RNA. It will also express some of the proteins. And so the RNA will bind to the proteins to circulate and find other, to kind of be a surveillance system. And whenever this virus comes in again, it will have this double-stranded RNA, which will be the same as the RNA introduced. And if there's a perfect match, you will cut it up. I'll show you this situation. So this is the RNA from the virus. Okay? And this is the unique sequence that the bacteria remembered. So it's now expressing a little bit of that RNA. And there's some other spacer sequence. And this is the protein that is here. This is the protein that's expressed in here. And this is the RNA that is expressed. And so the RNA and the protein are together. And then they will go to look for other bad guys that can match up. So what happens is that anytime you see this complete matching here, followed by an NGG sequence, the bacteria will know this is that virus that infected you before. And what happens is that it will cut the double-stranded DNA. It will say, okay, then this guy is bad. It will cut the DNA. Okay, and that's how bacteria, once it's was heard by a virus, learned to attack this virus next time it comes in. The question is, the bacteria itself also have the sequence in its genome. How come it doesn't attack itself? Do you know? That's right. Because, so actually, when it tried to look for a unique sequence, it only have this. It doesn't have the NGG. So when the virus come in, the bacteria needs to know not only this is a unique sequence in the virus, after that sequence there needs to be an NGG nucleotide. And so only this is inserted in the bacteria without the NGG. So the bacteria only cuts the viral DNA but not the bacteria own DNA. Okay? And that's how it remembers to recognize bad guys. Questions? Okay.
Are there viruses that don't have the NGG?
Viruses don't have any. NGG is something that, so can you guess how often NGG appears in the genome? Assuming a quarter chance, ACGT. Think. How often do we see an NGG?
1 over 16.
So the chance to see that first the gene is 1 quarter, right?
Well, it's 1 in 64.
The second NG is also this. But also, you can see this in both strands, either the positive strand or negative strand. So on average, every 8 base pair, you will see an 8 NGG. I mean, what's the chance that this bacteria is like whatever, KB long, has no NGG sequence? It's pretty rare. Okay, Pam.
So when it's choosing its little 20 nucleotide section to clone, it chooses a bit before an NGG? Or?
It's exactly the 20 nucleotide in front. There's nothing in here, and we're just drawing it this way, but it's right before that NGG sequence. Okay? And so that's how CRISPR works. And then Feng Zhang at the World Institute was really excited. He bacterial system, but then if we can introduce it into human, it's fantastic, right? It's like you have a place to, you have a way to break up the DNA wherever you want to break it. Not wherever, but like almost everywhere you want to break it. So anytime you have an NGG in the sequence, all you need to do is to design a 20 nucleotide sequence, RNA, and then bring the Cas9 into here, and it will bring, so this sequence plus the Cas9 will go into this. Once it sees the NGG, it will make a cut on the DNA. You can cut the DNA almost everywhere you want, on average, every 8 base pair resolution. Okay, so that's pretty fantastic. The thing is, if the cuts happen to be on the DNA of a gene, like an exon of a gene, what's going to happen is, do I have a slide for this? No, I don't have. Maybe I do. I remember that. So what happens in here is, if you cut on the exon, when the cell is trying to repair, so you know, like when you cut the DNA into a junction, you know, chromosome end is, there are some kind of decorations at the end. They know this is supposed to be an end, but then if you have a loose end that from CRISPR cutting, the cell will know, oh, I have a DNA damage, it will try to repair it, or try to stitch it together. And when it's trying to do the stitching, there could be insertions and deletions happening there. And that will essentially, I mean, if you have one nucleotide more or less, that gene is dead, because they become totally out of frame in the translation. Okay, and that's how it creates a loss of function in the gene. So here's a summary. CRISPR-Cas9 is the bacteria adaptive immune system and later introduced to other organisms. And so this is the same thing, the genomic DNA, and this is the Cas9, the sgRNA. So this part is doing the complementarity, and this part is kind of helping to recruit the Cas protein. And once it recognizes the matching, follow the PAM sequences, that NGG sequences, so once it recognizes, you will make the double-stranded cut, okay? And so two things will happen after this. If you don't give it anything for repair, the cell will know to try to repair it because there's the other chromosome. It will try to use it as a template, just stitch the two ends together. And in the stitching process, you usually, if it's on the gene, it will get, you will create these small insertions and deletions. You know, this thing didn't happen before. And now you inserted, say, two nucleotides, that gene is dead. Okay? However, if you create a donor, so these are two loose ends, but if you give it something that left side look like this, the right side look like that, and the middle part is something you want to change, then you can change it. And so using that, you can, you know, create a dinosaur from lizard, or you can create a smarter monkey or human, and that's money, and that's why you see all these patent wars. Okay? And so it depends on whether you give it a template, the repair is different. And so how is this going to be used in kind of, we're talking about a cancer study now, how is it relevant to the cancer study? It's like this. You want to do this also in a screening setting to test which gene is important for cancer. Okay, and so you again create a little viral particle. Each virus will contain, so this plasmid will have expression of the guide RNA. So basically what do you need to cut? You need the RNA and you also need this Cas protein. And both of them can come into that little plasmid. It expresses the Cas protein and you will also express the guide RNA sequence. And you put that into this little virus. And each of them will contain a different guide to cut out a different gene. You will go target a different location in the genome. And this is a whole mixture, and you grow a lot of cells. We're talking about like 60 million, some big petri dish, okay? And then you infect the cell at fairly low concentrations to roughly make sure that each cell only takes up one virus. Because if you take up more virus, you just, you know, go crazy. You want to each cell to roughly just take one virus. So usually this is by 3 cells per virus concentration, 3 to 1. And then after that, you do a drug selection. The initial drug is only when the cell can take the virus, it will survive. Two-thirds of the cells are gone from this process. And then you start growing the cells, DNA sequence. So remember, this guide RNA needs to be transcribed from a DNA template. But this thing gets incorporated into the incorporated into the host cell DNA, and so the DNA copy number for that guide corresponding to how many cells contain that guide. Does that make sense? If more cells get infected with this virus, later on when you sequence, you will see more copies of that. Okay? And so when you do the CRISPR screen, it's like you watch, okay, so at 0 day, what we mean 0 day is you use the drug to select out all those cells that doesn't have the infection. Okay, so they all take in a CRISPR. You do the sequencing. Because we made the library, they are fairly even. So for example, for this gene, in order to make sure you can design multiple guides on the same gene, okay, I'm just making it. So this gene, we put the four guides in here. Initially, when you sequence, you can see they are mostly similar abundance because you're trying to make even distribution in the initial library. And then you grow the cell, let's just say for like 2 weeks' time, right? In 2 weeks' time, again, we just sequence the DNA. We do not sequence the whole cell. You just amplify the guide DNA sequence to see. So 20 nucleotides is sufficient. Okay? With that 20 nucleotides, in day 14, you will see, okay, these guides, they become much less abundant in the final pool that you sequence, or in terms of percentage, or in terms of count. This would mean that we are using these guides to get rid of the gene. And this gene, once it's out, the cells are growing less or dying faster. Either they're growing slower or they're dying faster, right? So they become less abundant. And so anytime you see something become less abundant, it means this gene itself is essential for the growth. Does that make sense? Whereas if you have another gene, it has also a number of these different guides, initially it was about the same concentration or count, and then 2 weeks later you do the counting, it becomes much more abundant. That indicates you are knocking out the gene that normally inhibits growth. And now the brake is gone, the cells run faster. Okay? And so you can imagine you do this experiment. There are 20,000 genes in the human genome. And we only need to sequence by the way, in order to make sure you don't just have one guide, you can see here the count, each count is kind of a different cell containing this guide, right? And so you have enough representation in the cell. Usually you sequence like 30, 40 million, this 20 nucleotide sequence. It's good enough to get you very quantitative information, which is cheaper than like RNA sequencing. Okay? So what can you use it for? What can you use it for? The first is what people call negative screen, which is you have a cell growing on the petri dish, you apply the CRISPR, each of them taking a different guide to knock out a different gene, and you just grow this for, say, 3 days, or no, sorry, 3 weeks. Usually, to get a good result, you grow the cell for about 10 cell cycles. So you get, then you can see, for example, this gene in the original condition, you see the guide. But then after 3 weeks, they are no longer in the cell population. That means this gene is very, very important for that cancer cell, right? So you use it to identify the cancer vulnerability genes. This has been done at Dana-Farber. It's one of my colleagues who was heading the Achilles project. There's a pediatric patient with some cancer. They did a mutation profile in nothing. They didn't find any drug. And then the tumor can turn out to be growing into a cell line, a petri dish. And they did this CRISPR screen. They identified some genes that are important, and that gene has a drug. The kid can be treated with that therapy. Okay, so you test many, many genes from this one cell line. Of course, from here, you also want to make sure that if it's a ribosomal gene, you kill it. Yes, of course the cell is dead. You don't want to target those pan-essential genes. You want this particular cancer is uniquely sensitive to one gene. That is the drug you want to give the kid or the, whatever the patient. Okay, that's one type. The other one is what people use for resistance mechanisms. It's like this. If you have a cancer cell line, say it has a mutation, you treat the cell with this CRISPR, you will knock out different genes, and then you apply the selection, which is the drug. You add the drug, and then, so after the drug, you can see, for example, this is a BRAF mutated cancer cell line. It will be sensitive to the BRAF inhibitor. So when you use a BRAF inhibitor, a lot of the cells will die, or they're not so healthy, they don't grow very well. But then a few of those will be winners. So you knock those genes out, the cells are not, they don't care about the drug anymore. They become resistant. So these will also give you the very important, the resistant genes. Okay? Using this approach, you can also find the synergistic genes. For example, if you apply for the drug a little bit, don't give it too much, because if you have too many, like too much salt, you kill everything too. But just a little bit of the drug, and you ask, maybe some other gene, when it's knocked down, the cell will be even more sensitive to the drug. That is also a good way to identify a combination of two drugs together to target this cancer. Okay, so this is a very, very powerful way to help you identify which, for example, if you do these kind of screens, you can identify what gene is important for the sensitivity of the cell to the drug. What's the biomarker? Kind of you get a biomarker. You also identify both resistance mechanism and the synergistic drugs in combination with the original drug. So it's a super, super powerful technology. The world also holds the patent for doing these kind of screens. Okay?